Robert Byrne is going to introduce our keynote speaker. I've known Robert for 10 years, and there's probably not a person in the industry that I've found that's more passionate about demand. First time I ever started covering demand sensing, demand translation, I was doing a report, and I said, who should I talk to in the industry? And they said, the first person you should talk to is Robert Byrne. An hour later, I was talking to Robert, and he's taught me a lot, and I appreciate his innovation and his pioneer spirit to really drive new forms of analytics. So Robert, why don't you come up, and let's introduce our keynote speaker, and let's talk about growth, that gnarly issue of how does the supply chain drive growth and what's happening in the global economy? Thank you for your help.
Thank you. Just quickly, I started at Unilever as an inventory analyst 30 years ago this year. At the time, I reported to the director of logistics, who reported to the VP of manufacturing, right? Now Unilever has a chief supply chain officer who sits on the board and owns manufacturing, engineering, quality, customer service, logistics, and of course, planning, right? So that's true for many of you. I think it shows the importance of supply chain to your companies, and really also to the global economy. So, not just supply chain is not just an engine of growth for you guys, it's also driving increases in per capita income. I just saw something yesterday, the biggest market for smartphones in the world, China, right? That wouldn't have happened without supply chain. So with that, I'd like to introduce our next speaker to talk about the global economy. Dr. Laura Andrea Tyson. She is a professor and director of the Institute for Business and Social Impact at the Berkeley-Haas School of Business. She served as dean of the London Business School from 2002 to 2006 and as dean of Berkeley-Haas from 1998 to 2001. Laura was a member of the U.S. Department of State Foreign Affairs Policy Board and a member of President Obama's Council of Jobs and Competitiveness and the President's Economic Recovery Advisory Board. She also served in the Clinton administration as chair of the Council of Economic Advisors, 93 to 95, and as director of the National Economic Council, 1995 to 1996. She's a member of the board of directors of Morgan Stanley, AT&T, CBRE Group, and Silver Springs Network. She is an economic advisory board member of the World Bank's International Finance Corporation. So please welcome Dr. Tyson.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me. And let me say that when I got this invitation, I was telling Laura I don't do that many speaking engagements anymore, but I choose them on the basis of things that really interest me. And believe it or not, supply chain really interests me. I really think the supply chain is really, to understand the global economy, one needs to understand the supply chain and what you do. So it's really an honor to be here today, and I've already learned some really amazing things. I was asked to talk about the ups and downs of the global economy. Now, I want to say, I think you'll understand, that's a pretty tough assignment. The global economy is complex, it's unpredictable, it's volatile, and we did have the worst economic downturn engulf most of the global economy in the last 100 years in 2008 and 2009. So we're not in a situation that has been, say, typical of the 25 years before that great contraction. Economists were talking about things like the great moderation, the fact that inflation rates were coming down all over the world, the fact that interest rates had come down all over the world, the fact that growth was strong and sustained across regions. We were applauding the great moderation. And by the way, since I'm going to be talking about the future, I was asked to talk about the future, I'm just going to start with a note that almost no one predicted what happened in 2007, 8, and 9. Almost no one. A few people, but the weight of my profession around the world missed it. So that is a warning about forecasting and economics. The most recent International Monetary Fund survey describes the global economy right now as an uneven recovery continuing. But of course, the IMF and any other forecasting organization will then provide a huge list of downside risks. The downside risks. How much of a slowdown will China succumb to? What about the effect of sanctions on the Ukraine, on Europe? Europe is in a double-dip recession and confronting deflation. A Ukraine-sustained crisis with economic sanctions would not just harm Russia, it will also harm Europe. Japan, a year ago we were all applauding Abenomics. We were going to see a resurgence of a new Japan. A year later, doesn't seem that way. And then, of course, there's the ongoing, everyday discussion of when the Fed will change interest rates and what that will do, not just to the U.S. economy, to the global economy. So those are just examples of risks. And I'll try to talk about each one of them in a little more detail. Now, I want to start with the notion of the unpredictability, as I said. And then I want to start with a kind of big mega theme out there right now, which is at the heart of what you do, the global economy. And that is globalization in retreat? Is it in retreat? So the first thing is I was lucky enough to be part of a McKinsey Global Institute report. I do about a project a year with McKinsey Global Institute. All of their reports are free and online, and I think they are very good. So about 6 months ago, McKinsey decided to sort of look at, let's forget this discussion of this globalization and retreat. What are the facts? What are the facts? So I've just put together here the main facts. The main facts are, yeah, the globalization of the economy as measured by cross-border flows of goods, which is mostly what you are engaged with, cross-border flows of services, cross-border flows of financial flows. Yeah, it took a hit between 2007 and 2009, but the goods cross-border flows have come back strong. The cross-border flows of services continue to grow. The only thing that really has not recovered at all is cross-border flows of finance. But you know what? A lot of the things crossing borders in 2007 and 2008 were essentially part of the mortgage-backed security process, part of unsustainable flows that were speculative. So I'm not too concerned that cross-border financial flows are down significantly. I'm happy to see the cross-border flows of goods up, surpassing the 2007 peak. 35% of all goods cross national borders. Services, you can't expect that much. A lot of services are local, but with all of the digitization and technology we're talking about, cross-border flows of services are increasing. And then, of course, my last point, cross-border flows of data and communications. Very hard to measure. We sort of measured it one way, 50% a year, changing everything, changing the way you do business, changing the way you reach your suppliers, the way you reach your customers. And I just noted that in our discussion in the report, we talk about the various things that eBay and Alibaba are doing to facilitate globalization. So is globalization in retreat? The facts don't support that. The facts support we had a contraction because the world economy contracted. We're coming out. However, there is a discussion of whether there are some concerns. Let's just say there are some concerns. So the first one is, I mentioned, cross-border capital flows. Now, I said a lot of that was speculative. I don't worry that much about it. I think it was not sustainable. But I do worry about the fact that cross-border flows in foreign direct investment are down. That's the long-term patient capital that builds the bricks and mortar around the world that holds the supply chain and companies together. So that is down. A second thing, obviously, countries all around the world, we see this in the NSA situation, but there are others, are putting controls on the internet to protect privacy, to stifle dissent, to thwart cyber attacks. I don't know about you, but the scariest, absolutely scariest presentations I have sat through in the past 6 months have been about cyber attacks. Absolutely have been about cyber attacks. So that's an area where no one's really prepared or understands the issue. But it is encouraging people to set up controls, particularly at the national level, which can thwart globalization. We have not seen a lot of progress on trade liberalization. There are two big trade agreements under discussion. the Transatlantic Agreement, the Trans-Pacific Agreement. The odds of those passing anytime soon are actually quite low. There is, of course, the rise of nationalism around the world. This is quite amazing when you think about it. We've got a global economy. We've got more and more goods and services and information crossing borders. And at the same time, we have a growing number of countries and regions looking nationally. I'll just point out the vote that is impending on Scotland in the UK as a non-violent issue of nationalism, but nationalism nonetheless. And then, of course, people do worry about the fact of, is the U.S., the architect of the global system, stepping back? Are we no longer willing to serve as his guarantor? Therefore, there would be no hegemon. There would be no major power who said, this is it. This is the global order. We will stand behind the global order. The consequence of all these concerns are geopolitical risks are on the rise. They are almost certainly underpriced. You can ask yourself, are you pricing the risk right? And, of course, what it means is that risk assessment becomes even more important, resilience becomes even more important, insurance in supply chains even more important. So the concerns, the facts are, yes, globalization is strong and continuing. Yes, there are concerns. Risk is underpriced. Now, before I go out and talk a little bit about some of the issues Laura mentioned, like where is growth increasing, decreasing, what is the growth outlook, I do want to point out that there are huge uncertainties in forecasting, and economists tend to have much too much hubris about it. And I just have a list up there of big turning points that we missed, whether we were economists or geopolitical experts. We missed the fall of the Berlin Wall. We missed the time of the demise of the Soviet Union. We missed the fact that China was going to emerge post-Tiananmen to become a major global economic power. We missed the East Asian financial crisis of the late 1990s. We missed the 2008 financial crisis. I already mentioned that. We missed the Arab Spring. We applauded it when it happened, but we didn't predict it. And we haven't predicted what has happened since then. And, boy, did anybody know about ISIS just a few months ago? No. So we really have to be careful. Economists might refer to these things as exogenous shocks. That means we don't have to predict them. Oh, they just happened. We didn't predict them. But they have a big effect on economic trends. I pointed out that in a more specific way, right now, if you went back to 2008, 2009 and predicted how economies were going to come out of the economic crisis, you would not have predicted that Europe was going to end up pretty much on the path of Japan after 1989-90, a complete lost decade, and I'll talk about that. You would not have predicted the evidence of the fact that even as the U.S. recovers, the growth rate is significantly lower and likely to remain significantly lower. There's a fun project that I just was reading about. It was discussed in the Financial Times this weekend, and I know the people working on this. They've been working for several years on, can you distinguish good forecasters from bad forecasters? Are there super forecasters, people who on average do much better than the forecasters? And they say yes, and they also say that people can learn to be better forecasters. So one thing they say to learn to be better, so for all of us, every time you make a forecast, be willing to assign a probability. It's no good to say likely. It's no good to say unlikely. You got to do a probability assessment and then continually adjust that assessment. I have down here economists are more able to predict direction of change rather than the timing or magnitude of change. Think about how frustrating that is for you. I might be able to say, I think the global economy is going to pick up next year. I'm much less able to tell you how much, and I'm much less able to tell you exactly when. So I have the most recent example of this, Robert Shiller. Robert Shiller is a great economist. He's a Nobel laureate. He's a financial market economist. He predicted the stock market crash of the internet bubble crash. He predicted that. He wrote a book called Irrational Exuberance. He talked about all the issues that were going to lead to that. He predicted that. He was pretty one of the people who predicted the housing market crash. He did not predict the overall recession that followed, but he got the housing market crash just about right. his latest prediction is on stocks. He says, U.S. stocks are very expensive. They are very overvalued by his calculation. Nonetheless, he says, I don't know, the market could stay at current valuations for years. So what? He got direction overvalued. The timing of the change, no. The magnitude of the change, no. So these are all confessional points I'm making. So whatever I say, you have to understand that economists can do directions, but they cannot do timing or magnitude very well. This is extremely frustrating to you. Believe me, it was extremely frustrating in the times that I've advised presidents. They kind of look at you and say, really? That's the best you can do? So you can see the problem. Nonetheless, I'm going to sort of talk about, maybe I'll try to identify some things and give some probabilities to them as we go through it. So where are we right now? In order to understand where we are right now, and so this is kind of like a 1 to 3 year prediction, I said, let's say, what are some things we think we can say 1 to 3 years are going to be the case? One is the fact that there's going to be a continued shift of economic power to Asia, to China and Asia. That is not going to reverse. It's simply not going to reverse. However, in that, I think it's fair to say that China will not be growing at 10% a year. It's more like 7, maybe 6.5 to 7. And China is going to be rebalancing away from exports and investment-driven growth to more domestic growth and services. So when you're thinking about your supply chain, those are things to think about. Faster growth in the U.S. relative to where we've been the past several years. The economic recovery in the U.S. has been about 2%. It's never gotten above that. That's a slow recovery rate. That's half of the post-World War II recession recovery rates. So I think the U.S. is going to do a little better than that. That's why I'm willing to say faster growth in the U.S. So more in the 3% range than the 2% range. And of course, faster in the U.S. also means relative to the next group of developed countries, Japan and Europe, where I'm much more pessimistic. I'm pessimistic about Japan because even with a strong prime minister, you don't seem to be able to get any significant structural reforms, reforms, for example, in land use, reforms in services, key areas of the economy which are held back by inappropriate regulation. So Japan is throwing monetary policy in the direction of growth. It's throwing even more fiscal stimulus, even though its debt to GDP ratio is like 250%. But it doesn't seem to be able to move forward with structural reform. And besides that, it's got huge demographic issues. It is a declining economy in terms of the demographics and unable to address that through immigration. So I would say Japan, it's hard to see anything changing in the next 1 to 3 years. And Europe, and we'll talk about this a little later, I am really worried about Europe right now because much of Europe has simply not recovered from the recession. There's one chart I'll show you if I have a time. Somebody just charted the recovery of Europe from the 2009 recession to today in terms of how close they are to get back to their GDP growth rate that they might have predicted before the recession. If you look at that trajectory, they're worse off now than in the recovery from the Great Depression. They're worse off now than Japan was in the recovery from the 1989 stagnation. The point is Europe has not made any significant progress at recovering from the 2007 to 2009 recession. So, those are my depressing. We can talk about Africa. I'm quite positive on Africa, but Africa is a small part of the global economy. So if you're thinking about what's pulling the global economy, that's why I said it's Asia and China-centric Asia. Divergent trends in monetary policy. So you all have to worry about a lot of things. Maybe you don't have to worry about interest rate risk. You probably certainly have to worry about exchange rate risk. Well, so we're right on the verge of a major shift. The Fed at some point is going to be starting to run a tighter monetary policy. That will push interest rates up in the United States. At the same time, Europe's facing deflation. The European Central Bank had just announced he was going to do QE2, and he just reduced interest rates. So basically, you have U.S. rates poised to rise, European rates falling, without any sort of evidence that they will, that European monetary conditions will tighten. Japan, no. Japan, the yen already on the basis of monetary stimulus in Japan and fiscal stimulus in Japan has already depreciated on a trade-weighted basis 30 to 40% to the advanced industrial countries. So there's a lot of exchange rate risk embedded in countries following significantly different monetary policy. The exchange rate risk is not only just for the developed economies, but also for the emerging market economies. Because if capital starts flowing significantly, if there are changes in carry flow trade, carry trade flows between, say, Japan and the U.S., or the emerging market countries get affected by this. So there's greater volatility in global financial markets, which means greater volatility in exchange rates and in interest rates. And then, of course, there's the issue, another one that must be very important to all of you, and that's energy prices and commodity prices. And then you have, I'm going to talk a little bit about this on another slide, the game changer coming from North American energy independence. But also, I put state capitalism here, the fact that oil and gas markets, oil markets in particular, have always been affected by nationalism, by state goals about what they want their national suppliers to do, by interventions in energy markets for geopolitical purposes. So those are just there. Interest rates, I mentioned this. I basically really want to point out here again, and maybe we'll get better with big data and analytics, but the truth is that economists have been quite bad at predicting interest rates. So I remember I used to say to President Clinton, because I was responsible at the Council of Economic Advisors for economic forecasts, and we got our forecasts were actually pretty good on growth rate for the U.S. economy and on inflation rates for the U.S. economy. But our forecasts on interest rates were not very good. So I used to say, you know, we could do these models and we can get you right on growth and we can get you right on inflation. We may not be able to get you right on interest rates, which suggests there's something wrong with the model because all these things should go together. But the point is that we have had falling real interest rates for a very long time. Real, that is, inflation adjusted interest rates. And we're not sure why. There's a lot of debate about this. They've been falling in the U.S., they've been falling in Europe, they've been falling at the world level, and that is the way it's been for a long time. We are getting better because the Fed and the European Central Bank are helping us get better at this, at predicting what's going to happen on short-term rates, because unlike the Fed or the ECB, unlike the Fed of the 1990s, when Alan Greenspan's view was surprise the market, don't tell the market anything, surprise them. The value of what we can do is in our surprise. The current Fed leadership, and that's been true for most of this past decade, are committed to trying to say to the market, this is what we're going to do, this is what we're looking at, you look at it too, when we change things, you won't be surprised. So I think we get better at saying short-term rates, a little still weak on the timing, but that's because the Fed's weak on the timing. So right now we kind of know at a certain point short-term interest rates are going to rise. And the Fed knows that too. The Fed is not entirely clear when that will occur because they say, look at the data. We're looking at this data. You look at this data. When it's clear, we'll make an adjustment. Okay, but anyway, we have a sort of sense of the factors that move short-term rates and their monetary policy factors. So listen to the monetary policy authorities and what they say to you. Now, in principle, if short-term rates rise, then medium-term rates you might expect to rise, and long-term rates you might expect to rise. Well, that turns out to have been a prediction that doesn't always hold, because there are lots of things that drive medium and long-term rates besides the short-term rate. Expectations of inflation. So right now, expectations of inflation, extremely well-behaved in the United States, have been below 2%. You cannot see in any of the expectations data any expectation that the inflation rate is going to rise above 2%. In Europe, the expectations numbers are actually towards deflation at this point. Well, if you have a very low long-term inflation expectation, you're going to have low long-term interest rates. Even if the short-term rate goes up, the long-term rate is looking out there at the future saying, I don't need to get a nominal increase in my return because the inflation rate is going to be low. So we have, and then we just have what I would call risk appetite. So one of the major things that's happened, so back in 2010, 2011, 2012, there were a lot of economists and a lot of policymakers, and the IMF was part of this, saying it's getting really worrisome that these governments are issuing all this debt. Because as the debt of a government rises relative to GDP, we expect interest rates will rise. Why? Because that government will basically be scaring people about inflation or will be out there competing with the private sector for long-term capital. So for a couple of reasons, people were saying long-term interest rates are going to rise now because the governments are accumulating too much debt. What happened? Long-term interest rates fell and fell and fell to the point that Bernanke, then the Fed chair, gave a major speech and he said, you know what? There is no simple relationship between government debt and real long-term interest rates. Forget it. It doesn't exist. You have to look at things like the expectations of growth and inflation, and you have to look at risk appetite. It turns out that investors of the world think of government debt, particularly U.S. government debt, as a liquid, risk-free asset. They like to hold it. They want to hold it. So the government issues more debt. Who buys it? The Fed buys it, but also the central banks around the world buy it. Also, a lot of investors around the world buy it who want a liquid asset. That keeps long-term interest rates down. So the risk appetite, the shift to liquidity preference is very important here. So if you're thinking about interest rates, it is very hard to predict. If you're thinking about energy prices, so first of all, oil prices set in world markets. That's important because a lot of people say, oil independent North America will change oil prices in North America. No, will not. It's a world oil market. World oil prices will be affected by the supplies in North America. But unless we go to building borders around the world energy market, the world oil market, it is not energy independence of North America that matters. It's how much additional supply of oil comes. At the same time, another major driver of world oil prices is actually China, huge driver. So those first two elements suggest that over the next several years, actually, you will not see that. Remember just a few years ago, everybody was worried about peak oil. Everybody was worried about rising real oil prices as far as the eye can see. Then we had a realization of the change in oil reserves from the U.S. and Mexico. And we also had a change in China's demand for oil. So those factors are there. Natural gas is not easily transportable, as everyone knows. So when I think about fracking, and this was another really good report that McKinsey Global Institute did about a year ago called Game Changers. The Game Changers was for U.S. growth. What changes the outlook for U.S. growth on the supply side? And one was the fracking and the natural gas reserves, because it gives the U.S. production, it gives production in the U.S., U.S.-based production, a competitive cost advantage. I talked to someone last night about reshoring. Reshoring is partly because of that. It gives certain industries in the U.S. a real cost advantage, anything to do with petrochemicals and a feed chain coming through natural gas. So that is an important boon for U.S. growth, and it probably changes the patterns of natural gas movement around the world. But remember, it's hard to imagine the U.S. natural gas reserves becoming a major source of natural gas in other parts of the world. I want to point out the Russia-China oil deal. I don't know how many people know about this, but it's a really big deal. It's the biggest single trade deal ever. And it really is, Russia wants in energy, and certainly given what's going on with the Ukraine and Europe, wants to pivot to Asia in terms of selling its energy to Asia. So this is the first step. They have been exploring possible deals with Japan, and they may explore possible deals with North Korea. So this could be a major factor. Then I just mentioned in all of this, we have two big uncertainties. One is the geopolitical uncertainties. This is the favorite market to intervene in for geopolitical reasons. If you've got to go someplace to intervene, that's where you go, energy. And then I have to put here climate change because every day, including yesterday, we get a new report saying things are deteriorating at a much faster pace than anybody anticipated. We have what's commonly referred to in the press now in China as air apocalypse, which essentially means that China is becoming unlivable for the top leadership. When a place becomes unlivable for a top leadership, they will change things. They will change things. So it's possible we see a carbon tax. Okay, so let me now sort of talk about growth, because that's something Laura talked about, and it's very important. I already mentioned that there's an uneven recovery, that it is continuing. So we have had, after the contraction in 2008 and 2009, the world economy has grown every year. The EMEs, those are my emerging market economies. Emerging market economies have continued to outpace the developed countries. I put two-tier growth means that gap, the developed countries versus the emerging market economies. Sometimes there's three-tier because really in the developed countries now you get the U.S. pulling away from Europe and Japan, and then you have the emerging market economies. I guess emerging market economies are up here. And that, by the way, that emerging market as growing faster than the developed countries had been with us for the last 20 years. That is not going to change. That's simply not going to change. So you're thinking about where the strongest growth of the world economy is going to come from. It's from the emerging markets. If you look at these numbers, you know, back in the early 2000s, the U.S. economy was accounting for 67% of global growth. That was the early 2000s, coming out of the internet collapse. The growth of the global economy, U.S., 60 to 70%. Look at them right now. China, 40% of global growth. Asia, you add in the rest of Asia, you get to 60. The U.S. is down to 18. If that isn't a shift, I don't know what is. And I don't think that changes. I don't think that changes. This is just a chart that I like because it sort of says, what are the various ways that emerging market economies and their rise, their sustained rise over this 20-year period, what are the various ways they affect things, okay? Well, as their source of global demand, as consumers, you heard about cell phones in China, as producers, where lots of cell phones get produced in China as well, they are a major factor on costs. I talked about China and the emerging markets on commodity prices. Labor arbitrage. I mean, so much of what has happened in the supply chain over the past 15 years has been driven by labor arbitrage. And, of course, the labor arbitrage advantages, say, of India around Bangalore or of China on in the major cities on the coast, those arbitrage disadvantages have come way, way down. And then you have to think about where the newest wave of arbitrage advantages are. They will come down, too, because as the production of the developed countries and global companies move to exploit labor arbitrage or cost advantages, those cost advantages disappear. Another effect of emerging markets is on global interest rates. One of the things that happened really in the late 1990s, after the Asia financial crisis, is that the emerging markets, a number of them, led by China, realized they better run big, big current account surpluses and collect a whole bunch of foreign exchange reserves because capital markets could turn negative on them overnight. So what they did at the national level means that these countries were saving a lot. They were exporting more than they were importing. They were putting the difference into foreign exchange reserves. Think of that as self-insuring yourself against a sudden capital outflow. Well, what that meant was there was a lot of global savings looking for return. Now, I already mentioned that part of that shows up as central banks around the world holding U.S. government securities. That keeps the interest rate on medium and long-term government securities in the U.S. down. But they also were looking, not the central banks, but the sovereign wealth funds and the individual investors were looking for yield. That's part of the reason we got the housing. That's part of the reason we got the housing bubble. A lot of the money invested in mortgage-backed securities in the United States was foreign money looking to invest in higher yield securities, and they chose mortgage-backed securities in the U.S. So that's part of the savings glut, the search for yield when you have a lot of savings in the global economy. Wages and profits. I'll mention this now. I probably run out of time, so I'll do it now. In thinking about growth, we need also to think about the distribution, not just of growth, but distribution of income, and therefore the consumers that you deal with. So we've had a world in the developed countries, particularly pronounced in the U.S., but you see it in Europe as well, where technology and globalization is taking out middle-income jobs and middle-income growth. You get this polarization. You get high-income growth and high-income jobs, and a lot of people push down into low-income growth and low-income jobs. Or those people just disappear from the labor force altogether. They drop out. That affects the growth of demand for the kinds of products many of you sell. So it's not just the average growth rate that matters. The average is being pulled apart, is being affected by this pulling apart, but it is the distribution of growth. Okay, so, and then the final thing I put is emerging markets are very important for the rise of new competitors. So I don't know who in this room thinks they're competing with Alibaba, but Alibaba is the emergence of a new competitor. I'm thinking of writing a book about the rise of China as seen through the experience of Alibaba, because Alibaba was an idea in 2000 and 2001. And it certainly helped transform China, and it is slated to be, if not the biggest IPO ever, one of the biggest IPO ever. So, okay, so now I don't want to say too much about, because we're going to run out of time. I have a number of slides for those of you who are interested on the cost of the recession in the U.S. I'm just going to go to one amazing point. Okay. So think about this. How was the U.S. economy growing before it hit 2007, 2008? That's the notion of what its potential growth rate was. That might have been around 2.6, 2.7, maybe even 3% a year. Not bad. It gets knocked off of that trend, and it's never come back. It's not come back. So it's been growing at best at 2% a year. So how much is the lost output relative to where we might have been if we'd stayed on that trend? Look at that number. 78% of 1 year's GDP. The U.S. GDP is, what, $16.5 trillion, something like that? This is a huge cost. That Great Recession was truly great and painful, and painful to not just the U.S., but the world economy. There's a concept of hysteresis, which sort of gets at the issue, okay, why has the potential growth rate not come back? Okay, we can see there was a recession, we can see that, but why didn't we get back to trend? What's happened? Why has the trend line come down? Well, because during this whole period of time, there's been less investment than would otherwise have occurred. There's been less risk-taking. There's been less development of labor skills. There's been less labor experience. There are effects which have been long-lived, even though the recession itself will go down in the history books as, given the depth of the recession, one of the history books, the history will be, wow, they sure got out of that fast. They sure got into positive territory fast. But then the next part of the history book will say, yeah, but look where they got to. They didn't get to the growth rate they had before. So short-term outlook for the U.S. economy, in case you're interested, most people think next year will be stronger for all of these reasons. We have strong corporate balance sheets. We've had those for the whole time. They're really strong. Fiscal retrenchment, the governments, state and local governments in particular, are not contracting so much anymore, and that's a plus. The housing market is improving. The labor market is improving. And maybe, just maybe, we'll get some strength in CapEx, which has been on a downward trend for the last 30 years, but we got some things that might up it, okay? All the great technology you guys are talking about while you're here, big data and Internet of Things. Okay. let me skip these because I don't have time. Let me just talk about the long-term growth rate a little bit, so because growth is important to you. As I said, these are too many numbers here. The idea was potential growth rate of the U.S. was between 2.6 and 3 before the recession. Now, some estimates say it's down to around 2.1. That's the Congressional Budget Office. There's a real negative prediction out there by Robert Gordon, who's a very well-known economist, saying that's going to be even worse than that. It's going to be even worse than that. He actually thinks that growth in the U.S. economy over the next, say, 25 years will be half as much as it was in the preceding 25 years before 2007. And he has a variety of reasons for predicting that, demographics being one. But he is a technology pessimist. Okay, so let me just go to this slide. So he says, okay, the Industrial Revolution II, IR means Industrial Revolution, that was really big time. That changed everything. That transformed the world. There were productivity effects for 100 years from having the change in electricity running water, communications. Then we had the ICT Revolution, Industrial Revolution III. He says it was a bit of a ho-hum. It's over. We did it. The productivity effects were there. We saw them between 1996 and 2005. ICT is spread throughout the system. We got a productivity boost. Diminishing returns have set in. That would be his view. It'd be interesting to hear yours. He points out there's evidence that this is the case. If you look at productivity growth rates in the United States, you see they've been slowing before the Great Recession. That's really the unnerving thing. So the big discussion is, will productivity growth rebound? And why? If it does, why? So he's a pessimist about the Internet of Everything and social networking. He says, well, how's that really going to, what are the productivity effects of that? Left to this group in particular, I think, to answer that question. So this is my little, this is not a policy discussion, so I'm not going to go through all the things the U.S. might do to boost its potential growth rate, other than to say that right now a big discussion, of course, probably many of you know about, is tax reform, but I'll leave that alone. I'm not going to talk about U.S. fiscal outlook either. Happy to do it, but I want to make sure I touch a couple of other parts of the world. So China economic outlook, slower growth. Policy engineers, they want it to slow down. They do not think, and they are right, that 10% is environmentally sustainable, income inequality sustainable, sustainable from the point of view of commodity demand. They want to slow it down, and they have slowed it down. They have a very strong execution record on policy. They have a very strong leadership committed to market reforms. You can already see some evidence that they're beginning to rebalance growth towards domestic demand from exports and investment. They are committed, so watch for this over the next few years, and more of this, more and more of the transactions that your companies do may end up being denominated in renminbi. You may raise money in renminbi. There is a movement to capital and exchange rate convertibility. I should say, if you haven't gotten from this slide, I'm pretty bullish on China. So that would be my summary. However, there are risks. Housing and credit bubble, I actually think they can handle that. They have the resources to handle that. They have the will to handle that. It's a slow, steady cleanup of excess leverage and bubbles. Yes, it is true that China is being much more aggressive against foreign firms operating in China. They're not that interested in foreign direct investment as they once were. They are serious about their anti-monopoly laws. They are applying it to U.S. companies as well as Chinese companies. They are serious about their anti-corruption and will certainly look for the opportunity of going after a U.S. or a foreign company on corruption charges. They do have a series of policies. They've always had a series of policies which give preferential access to their own competitors. So it isn't an accident entirely that a company like Alibaba emerged to be the huge success. They had some preferential access in their rise, although they are a private company, not a public company. I suspect that the two greatest China risks are actually the last two. That is the disputes in the South China Sea as China becomes more nationalistic, and the air populace or the very daily health consequences of the energy catastrophe they have created in many parts of China. So I would say if you're looking at risks, those are my two. Europe. I am not optimistic on Europe at all. I think it's been a terrible tragedy, self-inflicted largely. So the UK, Germany, France, and the Netherlands have recovered to pre-recession levels, some pretty late, some pretty recently, much more recently than the US was the first to recover to pre-recession levels, not to the growth rate, but to the level. But Italy, look at Italy. It's at the level of output of 2000. Why shouldn't Italy say at a certain point, I don't actually want to be part of the euro? Exactly what has it gotten Italy to be part of the euro? Good question. France is essentially, it got back to pre-recession levels, but it is stagnating. Even good old Germany looks to be possibly on the brink of recession, hasn't gone anywhere in industrial production in 3 years, and Germany, more than any other country, would be hit by the Ukraine sanctions, if they're tough. Lost decade for the young. I already mentioned the EU doing worse in terms of recovery than Japan in the aftermath of 1989 and Europe in the aftermath of the Great Depression. So you got a negative outlook. You have the risk of deflation. Very, very scary. When you have a lot of debt, when you have a lot of weak banks that have not gone through the kind of capitalization stress tests that have gone, that the U.S. banks have gone through. So the U.S. banking system is actually very healthy because we have forced them in stress tests, we have forced them to recapitalize, we have created a system of getting them to a serious form of regulation which works. The Europeans haven't done that. So they have heavily indebted banks. They have some heavily indebted companies. And if you have deflation, of course, deflation increases the real cost of the debt. It increases the real cost of servicing the debt. It increases the possibilities of bankruptcy, which is essentially why everyone is really now very afraid in Europe, because the inflation rate is perilously close to zero. And the ECB has just driven interest rates to essentially zero. So what can you do? At that point, what can you do? So, and I just want to say the middle here, because it is my view that the policy errors are responsible for the failed recovery in Europe. This did not have to happen. The Europeans chose, at German insistence, to have a very restrictive set of policies, forced the periphery countries into massive, sustained depressions. That's where Greece is, that's where Portugal is, that's where Spain is. And essentially made it impossible even for the countries that were reasonably healthy, like France and Italy, reasonably healthy, to sort of grow out of the recession. So this is a big tragedy, I think. This is where I'm going to stop. Emerging market outlook. So I'm bullish on my general proposition that the world continues to be driven by emerging market growth. There are a variety of reasons for that. They continue to industrialize. They continue to urbanize. They continue to have the possibility of shifting large parts of their population from low productivity sectors to high productivity sectors. They have the possibility of leapfrogging in technology. That's happening. The dangers to them are China slowing down too much, getting more higher cost of capital. Should investors say, I actually prefer the higher return in the U.S. risk-free asset that I do in the emerging market access? That's why what's happening is investors have become much more discriminating among individual emerging markets. It used to be that emerging market assets was just a class. You invested in emerging market assets. Now you go, do I invest in Brazil? Do I invest in Turkey? Do I invest in Korea? So discriminating investors put more pressure on individual emerging markets. And then this is just an amazing point, and I don't know how many of you end up operating in failed states, but according to the World Bank and the IMF, 20% of the world's population live in failed or fragile conflict states. Syria is one of them. Half of them are middle-income countries. So the world is not a stable place for 20% of the world's population, and you don't have to go to the poorest countries to see signs of instability. Syria has probably given up 5 years of its development through the crisis that has engulfed it. So I guess I will stop there. I will say two things. One thing is just the role of technology, because my fascinating conversations around here have been about technology. So again, let me leave you with the challenge. There's a big debate going on about between technology optimists and pessimists. So the pessimists say that the current wave of technology change is not going to lead to the same kind of productivity advancements that we saw from the great industrial revolution of communications and electricity, or even from ICT. It's basically social networking is not the same thing. The Internet of Things is not the same thing. So technology and productivity, that's my question to you. How can you see it? And you heard from Laura, how can you drive it in your own organizations? Secondly, though, this goes to my point about inequality. Even when productivity growth has been strong in the U.S. and the other developed countries, median income has not followed. Real wages have not followed. So there's been this divergence between productivity gains, and we heard it shows up in revenue per employee, but not in terms of compensation per employee. And so you have this issue of the growth of demand ultimately, and how fast demand can grow if the technology is feeding productivity but displacing workers and displacing their income and therefore weakening demand. Technology affects both the supply side and the demand side. So I leave that for you to work out. And I think I have a little time for questions. I don't know, Laura.
We've got a couple of minutes.
Okay.
We're going to shift the program back. And so from your presentation, I think resiliency matters, right?
Resiliency really matters, yes. Risk assessment, risk using all the great data analytic tools that you have to assess risk, constantly reassessing risk, and building resilience for risk.
So Absolutely. The efficient supply chain. We've got a couple of mics. Let's see who has a hand. We have Kevin here. He's with Owens & Minor. Affordable healthcare. Mm-hmm. He's redesigning the operating theater for
fantastic.
A medical device. So,
fantastic.
Have at it.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Tyson. Question for you. Why the anemic and almost apathetic response to capital investment with historical and long-term interest rates?
So
Where's our sense of risk? Where's our sense of adventure and investment? And what's stymieing that?
It's a very good question. I think that the cost of borrowing, if you look at sort of, you know, models of what drives investment, the cost of capital does matter, so interest rate is a proxy for the cost. But the other thing that matters is expectations of demand for your product. Another thing that matters is you need to invest to move to the next generation of technology. So I think a major thing here has been the weakness of expected demand. So firms are not willing to build capacity in advance of a roaring recovery. Now, you can see the problem with this is it's self-confirming, because if CapEx is weak, that's one of the reasons the demand is going to be weak. And then the demand weak will make CapEx weak, so you got the whole thing going like this. But I do think if you ask companies, have strong balance sheets. A lot of them don't need to worry about the cost of capital anyway. They're taking the balance sheets and retiring their stock, purchasing their stock. They are making dividend payments. They are not doing the CapEx. If you ask them why, it's because of the weakness, uncertainty of demand. And that would be in the U.S., that would be the slowdown in China, that would be the Europe on its back, that would be Japan not recovering. And then you add to that the risk of the geopolitical risk in certain parts of the world. You're not going to invest for a big demand boom in the Middle East right now, or you're not going to invest in a big demand boom in certain countries in Latin America because you're not sure. There's been a lot of political change there. So that's the main reason. The main reason is uncertainty about demand. And then we have added to that, and this is a tragedy, governments, the European government, the U.S. government, they should have undertaken massive infrastructure investment projects during this period. They absolutely should have. It cost them nothing to do this, and any estimate of the rate of return on those projects is greater than zero. And the real return, the real cost to the government, was actually negative because of inflation. So it's negative. All right. They did not. They did not because people were concerned about the growth of government debt to GDP. But as I already pointed out, the evidence on what that does to interest rates, there was a kind of belief that it's going to have this major concern about interest rates going up, has not happened. So when the U.S., Standard & Poor's declared the U.S. as a credit risk, the market said ho-hum, and a whole bunch more money went into U.S. government assets. U.S. government assets are the risk-free liquid asset of the global economy. And right now, people want to hold that asset. So the U.S. government should be using it for a massive infrastructure project, not.
Bob, I think you've got a question. Bob Bowman, the supply chain brain.
Oh, yeah. Hi, Bob.
Thank you, Dr. Tyson. For years, it was conventional wisdom that capitalism would lead inevitably to democracy, with the exception of a small state like Singapore, for instance. Has China proven that theory wrong?
Uh-huh. Well, I think... I think that maybe you might say the jury's still out. You might say that Singaporeans themselves would say, and I have a number of friends from Singapore, maybe there are people in the room from Singapore, they would say that they're on the path. They are on a democratic path, that there's lots of things they would point to as forms of democracy that have come out of, it may not be exactly our form of democracy, but it is democracy. China has... Actually, local elections that are pretty open. They have a huge complaint system for local goods and services and violations in their own social networking internet system. So there's a lot of voice. You can give a lot of voice to democratic concerns in China as long as they're not central leadership concerns. So I don't know. I think the jury is out on China. I think the jury on Singapore suggests that there is evolution. The best book I ever read on this was written several years ago by Fareed Zakaria, and I would recommend that still as sort of making the argument for why capitalism leads to democracy, but also at that point saying... we don't yet know about Singapore, and we don't yet know about China.
Dr. Tyson, thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
I want to give you a copy of my
excellent.
Book.
Excellent. All right, thank you very much.
It's my hope in your travels Absolutely. In the world that you can help with imagine the supply chain of the future. We think it matters.
Yeah, it does,
and
for sure.
We really appreciate you coming today.
Great. Thank you very much.
We're going to move the agenda back 15 minutes, so we'll start again at past 5:30. Thanks very much.